Hello, everyone. My name is Sarah Squire. I work in the office of the CTO for Ping Identity. I'm an expert in identity and access management. It's a field I'm very passionate about. It's a field more people need to learn. And I'm here today to share with you the culmination of a three-year project to define common identity and access management terms. The project is called Identity in 1,000 Words. And what I've done is taken all the identity jargon I've heard in my many years in the field and defined each term using only the 1,000 most common words in the English language. The word 1,000 is not actually in the 1,000 most common English words, so that's why I call this Identity in 1,000 Words. Training people in identity and access management is hard because we're all busy doing our jobs. We don't have time to boil the concepts down into understandable terms. We don't have time to write shorter and shorter definitions until only the important things are left. So I took the time. I've run these drafts by hundreds of people in the identity and access management field. I've asked over and over again, can we make it shorter? Can we make it simpler? Can we make it clearer? These definitions are the result. If our executives don't understand the work that we do, they will not invest in identity. And that would be short-sighted because identity is the best investment an executive can make. So our job is to help them understand by defining our most important concepts in plain English. Let's start right off with identity. What is identity? I'm someone who works in the field of identity. What do I mean when I tell people that? It's tempting, but not very descriptive, to say, well, it's who people are. But do only people have identities? What about things? Servers, toasters, databases? Okay, so it's what things are. But that's not really very descriptive. What field do you work in? Oh, I work in the what things are field. So we need to get deeper into the weeds here. Ultimately, identity is descriptive. It's a noun, not an adjective, but at its core, identity is about describing. I have to say I'm really proud of this definition. A set of facts about a thing that make it what it is. People count as things, right? Yes, identity, what I am. The set of facts about me that make me who I am. That's what identity experts do. That's our stock in trade, ultimately. The value we provide as identity professionals comes from the value of wrangling all the facts about all the things that make them what they are. That's nice. I love it. Trust. We're really jumping into the deep end of the pool now. What do we actually mean when we say that? And what are we allowed to say in the 1,000 words? We're allowed to talk about promises. We're allowed to talk about truth and lies. Is trust a feeling? Is trust a metric? The NIST levels of assurance are a trust metric, right? What if we take that tack? What is in the levels of assurance that lets us know how much trust we should have? Well, there are reasons, right? Multi-factor authentication is a reason to believe that someone isn't lying about who they are. So what if we say that trust is a reason to think that a person or thing is telling the truth? I think that's super close, but trust isn't just about you're the right person or thing and you're giving me the correct information. Trust is also about how you will behave in the future. We have built entire identity federations. Higher education has a federation called In Common that has hundreds of participants who have agreed to trust each other. They created this mechanism for trust precisely so that they can better guess how other members of the federation will behave in the future. We want them to keep their promises about security and privacy and interoperability. So what if we said that trust is a reason to think that a person or thing will keep promises and tell the truth? That goes way beyond technology. That's what we want from our friends and colleagues, not just from our identity providers and relying parties. You're gonna like this definition. Are you ready? It's a trick question. Trust is already one of the 1,000 most common words in the English language. No definition required. Moving on. Authorization. What your users can and cannot do. Completely different from authentication, which we'll get to later. This one is about permissions. We could use a metaphor, something about hats with keys on them, something about round pegs and square holes. But those are all specific access control schemes. Attribute-based access control, or role-based access control, or claims. We need something broader. Authorization is just about what you're allowed to do. Allowing a person or a thing to do something. When we talk about authorization servers, we're talking about the engine that decides whether something is allowed, right? Allowing a person or a thing to do something. It sounds so simple when you put it that way. Let's move on to identity proofing. We covered identity, a set of facts about a thing that make it what it is. So now we just need to prove that. We need to make sure that the real world, the physical world, has the same facts about you that our digital system does. Has someone met you in person? Have they looked at your ID? Making sure that a person is who they say they are, that their computer facts match their real life facts. This doesn't say how we make sure. It doesn't prescribe ID cards or facial recognition. It doesn't say how sure we have to be. It's just a general process of making sure. I promised we would get here. Authentication. Authentication is core to the business of identity and access management. And one of the reasons that it's core to our business is that a lot of people get it wrong. NIST got it wrong in Special Publication 863, the Electronic Authentication Guidelines for Federal Agencies. The previous version of 863 outlined levels of assurance that conflated authentication and identity proofing. So there was no level of assurance that could describe a very well-authenticated pseudonymous user. And we need that use case. We need it for whistleblowers, for political dissidents. We needed it for the Iranian protesters who filled Twitter in 2009 with images of police brutality that their local media and government did not want reported. Identity proofing those people could endanger their lives. Not properly authenticating them might lead to their accounts being deleted or compromised. I'm a co-author on the rewrite of 800-63. We called it the Digital Identity Guidelines. And because we thought about these issues, because we broke down what authentication really is and is not, levels of assurance are gone. Now we have authenticator assurance levels and identity assurance levels, and we can communicate those separately. So authentication isn't about identity. It's about making sure that a person or thing is the same person or thing you saw last time, which is different from them being who they say they are. Okay, this one should be way easier. A password is just a secret, right? Well, we can't say secret, but we can get close. Something known only by the person who is supposed to know it. Again, does this give any indication that someone is who they say they are? No, actually, we just went over this. All we know is that they are the same person or thing we saw last time. So how about attributes? Metadata. Single, white, female, over 21, Seattle, Sarah Squire at pingidentity.com. This one's really easy. Those are facts. Facts about a person or a thing. Attributes. Simple. Assertion, more complicated. So close to an attribute, but subtly different. If I say that I assert something, there's an implicit statement there that it might not be true. If it were true, I would be stating it, not asserting it. Assertions are generally carried across the wire. There's a difference between attributes and assertions that has to do with communication between parties. Someone is saying something to someone else, and there's a trust relationship between them. Fact about a person said by someone you trust. So we took the definition for attribute and we added a verb, a communication verb. Someone is saying something to someone else, and we added the concept of a trust relationship. Doesn't have to be a strong trust relationship. Doesn't say how much you trust them. But even if you've never seen them before, even if they just dynamically registered from a sketchy IP address, they're still in the system. There's still some level of trust, even if it's near zero. Let's talk about single sign-on. This one's a classic. I can't tell you how many teams and companies say, we need single sign-on, and I say, that's wonderful, security win, usability win, great idea, how do you want to implement that? and I get a blank stare. As an identity nerd, I'm deep in the weeds. I actually don't use the phrase single sign-on a lot. I use OAuth, OpenID Connect, SAML. When I think single sign-on, I think about the specific technologies that accomplish that objective. When normal people talk about single sign-on, though, they are technology agnostic. They just want it to work. So how do we define what it is that they are trying to achieve? Well, it's complicated. It has to do with authorization and access management and credentialing. But ultimately, they want to use one key, sign into one place, and get into all the other places they're allowed to go. Letting a person or thing sign into one place and get into the other places they're allowed to go. Good. I like it. What about roles? When we talk about people's identities, the set of facts that make them who they are, this is a somewhat transient one. We want to capture the fact that it's active, something you're doing right now. The good news is that jobs is in the 1,000 most common words. Jobs and roles are super close in meaning. So we can just say a set of jobs that a person or a thing does. Great. So when we talk about role-based access control, we're talking about giving users the least number of permissions they need to do the set of jobs they're tasked with. Identifier. I love talking about identifiers. I actually had an identifier mentor early in my career. How awesome is that? He was assigned to tutor me in identifiers when I first started in identity. He gave me homework to go out and find identifiers and come back and discuss whether they really were identifiers. Were they unique? And the answer I found was that it depends on context. In this room, Sarah is probably a unique identifier for me. In this building, in this city, probably not. So it's essential in this definition that we include a context, a domain. But we can't say context, and you guessed it, we can't say domain either. The name of a thing, but only when that thing is the only thing with that name in that situation. I'm not super happy with including the word name in this definition. I think label would have been more accurate, but we can't say that, so name is good enough. Credentialing. This shouldn't be too hard. We already have a definition for password. We just need to add in some other shenanigans to account for different kinds of authenticators that could get you through a digital door. Something you know, something you have, something you are. Or in my case, something you'll forget, something you'll lose, and something you'll get a paper cut on. Giving someone a thing that lets them show that they are the person you saw last time, which again is different from them being who they say they are. That's so elegant. No long-winded explanation of multi-factor authentication or biometrics, just a basic explanation. System of record is a term we use in identity and access management to mean which system is the source of truth for a given piece of information. We have a constant problem in my field with something called cache consistency. We need to make copies of data, but those copies get out of date. And if we don't update them enough, we're giving people wrong information. If we update them too often, we're tying up all our systems. This one is tricky. I went through a lot of drafts on this one. It took a long time to get right, but I really like this definition. A place you can trust that holds the real things you want to know, not old out-of-date things. If two things don't agree about facts, this one wins. That's so great. Systems of record and cache consistency existed long before computers. They aren't actually technical topics at all. A six-year-old can understand the concept of information that's out of date. He thinks there are cookies in the cookie jar. He's unaware that his sister ate all the cookies. His mental cache is out of date. The cookie jar system of record wins by showing him that there are indeed no more cookies. Assurance. So we talked about trust. Assurance is very similar to trust. If we talk about levels of assurance, or now identity assurance levels, or authenticator assurance levels, what do we mean by assurance? It's a level of certainty, right? Well, we can't say certainty, but we can get close. How much I believe something that was said to be a fact. So I'm going to believe the facts in a token that's signed, a token that's encrypted, a token that was sent through a back channel, a lot more than I'm going to believe the facts in an unsigned, unencrypted bearer token that came through a browser that could have been tampered with. Those facts have a higher level of assurance. I left the hardest one for last. I've been talking to a lot of people about this one. I've talked to people working in social media, on encryption, on privacy law, in government, in higher education, in private industry. What do we mean when we say privacy? Is privacy a right? Is it a responsibility? I went through a lot of drafts on this one as well. I think it's an ability. Being able to say, who can know what about me? Whether anyone has a right to this ability, or the degree to which external entities are responsible for protecting this ability, is a policy question. Having a privacy-preserving or privacy-enhancing system doesn't mean that people can't share. It doesn't even mean that people can't share absolutely everything with the whole world. It does mean that they get to decide. They get a say. I like this definition a lot. So I want you to imagine an identity team lead pitching a CEO to get funding for his team, trying to get buy-in for specific technologies and explaining the exact protocols they want to use. We've all been there. It's incredibly frustrating. It's like screaming into the void. Instead, he could give this sort of pitch, the 1,000 words sort of pitch. I have an initiative to improve our identity infrastructure. Right now, our customers don't have a say in who knows what about them. So lots of them don't trust us and don't share their information with us. When they do share their information, we don't have a good way to track whether the things we know about them are out of date. So when a computer tells us facts about them, we can't be sure those facts are true. Also, sometimes people lie and pretend to be our employees in order to gain access to our computers. I would like to start up an identity and access management improvement program that will make it easier for our employees to prove that they are who they say they are, and will help our customers have a say in who knows what about them. That sort of pitch makes sense to executives. That communicates clear risk reduction and straight-up business value. Don't get me wrong. The weedsy technical parts of identity are super fun. The OpenID Connect tokens and relying party logout protocols and dynamic endpoint protection, I know. That's why I got into this field. That's why I've stayed in this field. But identity is much more than that. Identity protects our privacy. It makes our daily lives easier, and it puts attackers out of business. This project took me 3 years because clear, succinct communication is hard. I got an email from a mentor early on in my career, big, long, rambling email. And at the end, he said, I would have written you a shorter email, but I didn't have time. It's taken me years to get this talk down to 20 minutes so I could share it with you. Thank you for sharing these minutes with me.